Good morning and welcome to the 28th meeting in 2022 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to item 3, consideration of evidence in private. Are members all agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care on the financial memorandum to the National Care Service Scotland Bill. Mr Stewart is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Donna Bell, Director of Social Care and National Care Service Development, and Fiona Bennett, Interim Deputy Director for NHS Integration and Social Care Finance. I welcome you all to the meeting and invite Mr Stewart to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. Thank you for having me along today to give evidence and take questions on the NCS bill and the financial memorandum. This is an enabling bill which sets out a number of provisions. The National Care Service, as proposed in the bill, will bring together social work, social care and community health to strengthen the health and social care integration for adult services. By the end of this Parliament, accountability for adult social work and care support will transfer from local government to Scottish ministers. The government are establishing a programme of gathering evidence and undertaking research to inform future decisions regarding children's services and justice social work, and whether it would be appropriate for them to become part of the National Care Service. The aim of the NCS is to improve the already high quality and consistency of care across Scotland and to reduce variation, ensuring everyone, no matter where they live in Scotland, is provided with the best possible care. The proposed bill sets out that at a national level, the functions are focused on consistency through national oversight. Services will continue to be designed and delivered locally. That is right to support delivery with and for our communities and the people that they serve. The purpose of the NCS is not a nationalisation of services. The principles of any new system will be person-centred, with human rights at the very heart of all that we do. This means that the NCS will be delivered in a way that respects, protects and fulfils the human rights of people accessing care support and their carers. The NCS bill sets out a framework for change, but the key details will be developed as part of a co-design approach. The co-design is all about engaging and working with people, those people with lived experience of and people who deliver community health and care support. These are the people who understand the challenges best and who are therefore best placed to help drive forward the improvements that we all want to see. This represents a new approach, Convener, to drafting the detail of the bill. The intent is to work more collaboratively to reduce the gap between the legal and the policy intent and its delivery following the difficulties faced in realising the changes identified in previous service reviews. Integrated health and social care has long been the joint ambition of both local and national government, but people who access and deliver care have told us that this is not delivering the quality of services needed consistently. Combining national oversight with local expertise will ensure that the right balance can be struck in ensuring consistent and fair quality of service provision across Scotland, allow for better sharing of good practice and innovation, and remove unwarranted duplication of functions, making the best use of public funds. The financial memorandum sets out the estimated costs for establishing and running the National Care Service and the proposed local care boards. It does not cover any proposed changes to wider policy, such as those set out in the independent review. The financial memorandum does include significant assumptions on required investments in pay and terms and conditions for frontline local government care staff if they were to transfer to the NCS. There are still discussions ongoing with regards to any transfer of staff or assets from local authorities, and this is a key area for co-design and one which will not be rushed given its importance. Work is ongoing with all financial considerations under constant review as new information becomes available. To be clear, convener, we are not waiting for the NCS to start improving social care. We are already taking steps to improve the outcomes for people accessing care and support. And our priority will be to continue to be maximising frontline spending. The Scottish Government's commitment to fair work and the support for fair pay and conditions is a long-standing policy and will be embedded into the values of the new National Care Service. By rewarding and valuing the workforce to deliver the best possible service for the people of Scotland, we will make the sector fit for the future and more attractive to people coming into the profession. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much for that opening statement. And as traditional, I will start with some opening questions and then we'll move on to colleagues around the table. I think you started by talking about the fact that the stated purpose of the bill is to improve the quality and consistency of social services in Scotland. And I think throughout the evidence sessions, it's been the view of everyone that, you know, that is what we want to see. But why is this structure the best way to deliver that? Because what we've tried to tease out in questions, I don't think we've really had all the answers we would like, is that if there are some issues affecting some local authorities in terms of consistency and quality of care, why is that not being addressed, even through, as I said, when Ms Bennett and Ms Bell were giving evidence through naming and shaming? Why not say these are the local authorities that are not stepping up to the mark, they're not delivering the services that they should be delivering, rather than go for this all-encompassing new structure?
Well, convener, we need national high-quality standards. That has come across very clearly from those who are being supported by carers and by frontline staff who believe that national high-quality standards are the way forward. But I think the other thing about all of this, convener, is accountability. And, you know, having been in post now for 18 months, it surprised me at the very beginning how many of those folks who are being supported by our care system mentioned accountability. They do not feel that there is the accountability that there should be at a local level. And they feel that ministers should be accountable for more than just the policy direction that we are accountable for at this moment. And they feel that those national high-quality standards are absolutely necessary. That came across loud and clear in almost every conversation I have had with folks with lived experience of the care system. That has come across loud and clear from the Social Covenant Steering Group. And that has come across loud and clear from those folks who work on the front line. And let me give you an example, convener, without naming anyone. But, you know, where there are failings for people, you know, I've heard this story time and time again where folk have been pushed from pillar to post. Well, that's not our responsibility, that's the responsibility of the Health and Social Care Partnership, or no, that's not ours, that's the council's responsibility here, or no, that's the NHS's responsibility here. And that leads to real difficulties for people, and we need to change that, and that's why we need this change, to make sure that that accountability is there so that people know what they can expect from a care system.
Well, yes, I mean, the independent review said there was indeed a huge amount of consensus that a national care service was required to achieve consistency and quality. But what the Fraser Valander Institute said was that this is the new system being developed is unlikely to be any better unless it is funded to be better. And there's real issues about overall funding of the Scottish Parliament. We know the pressures that we're actually under. We've also saw last week some reprofiling of some £70 million with regard to this policy from the Deputy First Minister. So how likely is it that we're going to actually be able to see these positive changes that you want to see? I mean, can it be done, without investing the sums of money that are required, without impacting on other services?
Convener, we know that there are financial challenges, and you mentioned yourself there the emergency budget review. And it would be better for all of us here, I think, if there was some more clarity from the UK Treasury about public spending as we move forward. I think in all of this, we know that what we have at this moment in time is a system where huge sums of money are spent on crisis. We need to change that, and we need to make sure that for the future, that we invest in more preventative care, which will free up resources that are currently spent on crisis, which also has a huge human cost attached to it as well. The government has also said, as I'm sure as the committee is well aware, that we will increase our social care spend by some £840 million by the end of this parliament. Convener, we all know that we are going to have to ensure that we get things right for the future, particularly if there continues to be restraint on the public purse. And that is why I do not think that we can stand still. What we are proposing here is not change for change's sake. This is setting up a system, a social care system, that's fit for the future to deliver for the people of Scotland.
Will support the policy ambitions, but let's look more then at the finances of it. I mean, one of the issues that's been brought to our attention by witnesses is the scale of uncertainty in terms of the costing. So, for example, last week Fraser Valander said that one of their concerns was, and indeed this was supported by the Auditor General, that the costs which are on the face of financial memorandum, there isn't the workings beneath that to see how these costs have been arrived at. And why we have the breadth of costs that we actually do have. Now, we do realise that there's uncertainty and there'll be secondary legislation, etc. But in terms of actually financial memorandum, which is what we are trying to take evidence on, it is of concern that there aren't more detailed costings and actually involved in terms of the delivery of that.
Convener, the financial memorandum... The financial memorandum itself provides the estimated cost of establishing the NCS. And it should be noted that that does not represent a budgetary commitment, but instead provides an indicative cost which will be further refined as the co-design work progresses and uncertainties are clarified. Now, you know, folks are saying all of this should be in the financial memorandum, but the standing orders of the Parliament are quite clear, is that the financial memorandum should be what covers what is covered in the bill. Obviously, in terms of other refined work that we are doing, we will continue, as always, to report to Parliament, including committees like your own, around about what the expected costs are coming from some of the co-design work. If we were to make assumptions on some of these issues at this moment in time, we would probably rightly be accused of having already made our minds up around about certain aspects of what we want to do as we move forward. And that's not what we're about. This co-design is not lip service. We want the stakeholders, the voices of lived experience, local authorities and other public bodies, the third sector, carers and others to be involved in that co-design process. As you mentioned the Fraser of Allender, and I know that they said that they couldn't fully understand the financial memorandum until they got more information from the government. Can I say that the financial memorandum is published to support the detail provided in the bill, as I said previously, and that further detail will be available through future business cases. Discussions with Fraser of Allender Institute that was had between officials and them was to explain more about the financial memorandum and was not new information, as some folk have said it was. And, you know, with that co-design work still to take place, it would be wrong of us to make lots of assumptions around about the outcomes of that co-design work, convener.
I mean, I don't think anyone would be accused of making up your mind too early. I think people just want to ensure that this, you know, that this bill goes forward with solid financial foundations. And that is the issue that I think we are grappling with. So, for example, the number of areas where the financial memorandum fails to give any indication of likely scale of costs at all. So Audit Scotland, for example, lists a number of areas where no indication of costs has been provided, and these are significant. The cost of any national care boards, transition costs for local authorities and health boards, including double running, the impact of changes to VAT treatment, impact of any changes to pension scheme arrangements and associated contribution costs arising from pay harmonisation or rationalisation, the extent of potential changes to capital investment maintenance costs and the cost of the health and social care information scheme. So, you know, and there's also the issue of transfer of assets. So, I mean, you know, there are real issues here that more information could and should be forthcoming, surely, at this point.
Well, let's take the last example that you gave, convener, there about transfer of assets and of staffing from local government, which is one of the things that some folk have cottoned on to. We've taken no decisions around about the transfer of assets or the transfer of staffing. And, you know, that will all form part of the co-design. You know, and I've gone on record on a number of occasions saying, you know, in terms of the staffing, the local government staffing aspect, you know, there is already good delivery of high quality care in many places by local government. So why would we actually need that transfer to take place? But that is part of the co-design process. In terms of some of the areas that you touched upon, VAT, for example, that is an area where we are exploring in great depth, and we have sought independent professional advice on VAT implications of options available regarding the structural setup of the National Care Service. And of course, as you would expect, we are actually actively engaging with the Treasury to make early progress with obtaining a VAT neutral position. You know, it would chuff me to bits, convener, if we could get a prompt response from the Treasury on these kind of issues. But as this committee is aware, you know, the Treasury sometimes takes some time to come to decisions around about these things.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, though, if the VAT situation is not resolved, we could be the same situation we had with police and fire service, whereby, you know, millions of pounds has been, you know, contributed to the Treasury in VAT when it could be much better spent on local services. I mean, one issue, of course, which came out when the evidence from your officials was that not all staff may transfer. So we're talking about a national service, but some staff may stay with their local authorities and some may move. Is that correct?
Well, indeed, convener. And one of the reasons why we have put staff transfer into the bill is that local care boards will be, or maybe, depending on what Parliament does here, the provider of last resort. So it's important that we have the ability to have staff transfer in these situations. Just like as we have seen in recent times where there have been closures of services in the independent or third sector, or people deregistering services, we have seen those transfers take place between third sector, private sector, and other third sector partners, or indeed local authorities. And at this moment in time, that is happening on a fairly regular basis. But as provider of last resort, if that's what Parliament chooses, there has to be the ability to have the staff to ensure that there is a continuation of care for people. I don't know if Ms Bell wants to add to that, convener. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so and when we gave evidence before, the provider of last resort point is very important. We know that there are some areas that have already had to step in social care. I think the point that we drew out in our evidence was that in the independent review, Derek Feely was really clear, and we were really clear that local authorities provide excellent services across the country. And Derek was very clear in his report that local authorities could remain as providers of social care, and really that is a matter for discussion and negotiation with local government.
My door is open to local government. I will listen to what they have to say on many of these issues, and we will act accordingly. As I said previously, many local authority care provision is of high quality, and we would not want to see that go, convener.
I mean, what the Society of Local Authority Chief Executives said in evidence to us was, and I quote, "The financial memorandum does not represent the outcome of the Feely review or the National Care Service consultation. You cannot see the total costs. You are not able to look at what the priorities would be within them or to properly compare alternative models against what is laid out in the financial memorandum."
Well, I would disagree with Solace on that point. And, you know, I've seen estimates from others of possible costs. For example, COSLA itself has estimated that the cost will be in excess of $1.5 billion. And of course, they say that outstrips our pledge of £840 million of investment. I'm not sure where COSLA and others have got these estimates from. I'm more than happy to go through in depth with them where they get those estimates from, but we have not had sight of those, and I'd be very happy to take an overview of that. I think the other aspect of this, convener, is the independent review itself on the recommendations on the independent review itself are pretty wide-ranging. And they include areas such as the National Care Service, but also changes to other policies which are not necessarily included in the NCS. So, for example, they have got a great deal to say around about charging policies and other supports for carers. As I will reiterate again, each individual recommendation has and will continue to be subject to further policy work and financial assessment, as well as economic appraisal, because I know that the committee will be interested in that aspect of all of this too. And I would say that the numbers in this financial memorandum and COSLA's calculations are not currently compatible. But I'm more than willing to have COSLA explain to me their workings, and we'll equally explain back what our workings are and see where we can come to in terms of agreement around about some of these issues.
I mean, I think one of the difficulties is that COSLA, Solace, CEFA, etc. said that, you know, the consultation came out without any prior discussion, and therefore they were kind of caught in the hop with it. It also came out over the summer when they were trying to prioritise recovery from COVID, etc. And they also felt that it was a standard consultation time, and something of this magnitude should really have taken, there should have been a lot more time for them to actually develop and discuss issues with the Scottish Government and present more detailed responses.
They may argue that, convener, but we have been at this for a very long time. It's not just the consultation itself. There was all of the work around about the independent review and all that Mr. Feely has done in that regard. Voices were listened to there. And I have to say that from the point of view of the voices of lived experience, they think that all of this has been too slow. And if you were to ask them if the consultation was too short, the answer, I think, would be from most a resounding no. And a lot of people and a lot of organisations, a lot of stakeholders engaged with that consultation. I have spoken and listened to, which is the most important thing, thousands of people since I have come into post. Officials have been engaging with people right across the board in all of this. And I think, you know, if the committee were to bring forward some of the folks from the likes of the Social Covenant Steering Group, they would say that, no, this has taken too long and the consultation was the right thing to do, the right time, and that we need to move forward. But, you know, what I would say to the committee is just because the consultation is over does not mean that the engagement does not continue, because it will continue throughout this process. And a huge amount of my time and a huge amount of officials' time is spent in talking to stakeholders and the voices of lived experience in order that we get this right. And we want these folks to be fully engaged in the co-design process as we move forward.
Okay, I mean, one of the things that came out of the evidence was the potential impact on the viability of local authorities as an unintended consequence. So the ultimate role of the policy is to deliver for the people who actually require this service. But if there's a conflict between the viability of a local authority and delivering that service, where would we be? Because obviously, you know, some local authorities have very small management teams relative to others, who have a wide range of roles. If the expertise is perhaps transferred, possibly for very good reasons, then that means that that local authority may not be able to deliver on other areas of services. How much time has been spent looking at that particular issue?
Convener, decisions over funding are still to be determined. However, the intention would be that there would be no detriment to local government finances. Any funding to transfer would be directly associated with a similar transfer of costs to ensure an overall neutral impact. We recognise that in establishing a National Care Service, including any transfer of accountabilities and associated financial resources from local authorities, that we need to take consideration of the impact on those local authorities and their ability to resource and deliver other public services. And as you rightly point out, Convener, those scenarios may be more challenging for smaller authorities, island authorities, Clackmannanshire. And that is why we will continue to ensure as we move forward that we will have these discussions, those engagement. But what I would say is that we want to reach an overall neutral impact. But decisions over that funding, as I said at the very beginning, Convener, have yet to be determined.
Okay, I mean, the issue there is not about, you know, the funding being neutral. I mean, if as a management team is reduced, then there's a difficulty in them being able to deliver those services. So it may be that you have to retain a similar size management team in some of these local authorities, what they have already. So you end up with a diseconomy of scale, because if you're transferring some of these services, but ultimately you're still having to leave much the same team behind, you're then going to have to fund additional staff for those new services. So you end up with a more costly and some might think more cumbersome delivery, surely.
No, I don't necessarily agree with that. And one of the things, Convener, which this government and I'm sure this committee on numerous occasions has spoken about, and certainly Parliament has discussed at length over periods of time, is shared services, cooperation, collaboration, in order to do our best for delivering for the public, which is ultimately what we are all about. Now, I recognise you know, that there are some concerns in certain quarters around about aspects that you have described. And, you know, I've heard these firsthand. Ms. Bell and I were in Shetland the other week for a huge conversation around about National Care Service and the impact on Shetland. We will continue to listen and we will ensure that we do all that we can to ensure no detriment. But I think this scenario where you are pointing out the challenges, and you're right to do so, can also lead, I think, to a huge amount of opportunities in terms of shared services and ensuring that we are doing our level best to deliver for the public of Scotland.
Okay, and where would the third sector fit in with those shared services? Because we took evidence last week from the Alliance, who said, and I quote, that they feel that additional costs would be incurred in order to meet with information standards and data sharing and to update software, undertake training in relation to this. And while these costs might be modest relative to the overall scale of costs, this could be significant and impact on the individual viability of third sector organisations. So there's a concern that this could be an unintended consequence.
Convener, I have said to many a committee before that I'm a man who does not like unintended consequences, and that's why we will dig deep in all of this. I've got a great respect for the Alliance and their views. However, what I am unable to quantify at this moment in time is how much it actually costs to collect data at this moment, which is often quite disparate and can be very, very difficult in some regards. And we need to get better at all of this. And I think, one of our ambitions is to ensure that data collection is streamlined and becomes better. And in all of this, in order to support the improvement and benefit from data, one of our main planks within this bill itself is the investment in the workforce in order that we get this right as we move on. So, I'm more than happy to speak to the Alliance where they think there may be difficulties in this, but equally, I think that we would have to go back to them and say that some of the cumbersome processes that have grown, probably take a lot more time than a streamlined system of data collection would.
I mean, one of the things about the financial memorandum is that there's only 3% inflation built into that financial memorandum. As we know, it's already 10%. And you've indicated to the committee this morning that the intention of the Scottish Government is to fully fund this bill and these changes. Will it be fully funded at the prevailing rate of inflation? And what do you see is the impact on other local government services? Because there seems to be a contradiction with the resource services review that we had in May, whereby there's going to be a kind of flat financial cash settlement with inflation at 10%. That means significant reductions in service delivery and staff numbers, obviously, and yet we're going to have this service which is apparently going to deliver more effectively for more people, albeit there may be some savings, but there will be initially be significant costs in setting up this apparatus. So is the Scottish Government committed to inflation-proofing this bill?
Convener, an average was used at the time of the writing of the financial memorandum based on the forecasts available. We understand that more recent Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasts are now available and estimates will use the updated profile. And of course, we have seen a massive change in inflation in a very short period of time, which many of us could never be predicted. Inflation, as we all know, is very volatile at present and has moved markedly since the estimates in the financial memorandum. Our financial modelling will continue to reflect the most recent inflation rates, and we will update accordingly as we move forward. And with that, I'll bring in Ms. Bennett, if you don't mind, Convener.
Thank you. Just briefly, just to note as well, inflation is at 6.2% in the financial memorandum for this year and next, and then drops back down to the 2% in line with the Bank of England forecast.
Yeah, but the current rate of inflation is about 10%. The point I was asking was, will the bill be inflation-proofed? Because there's not much point in saying that we're going to actually deliver the funding for this bill if, at the end of the day, the reality of inflation is not reflected in terms of delivery of it. Whether it's 6.2% or 3%, that's no 10%. So, you know, we're already building in, as I mentioned earlier, the Deputy First Minister had to make a difficult decision with regard to funding of this bill only last week. How can we be sure that we end up with a service that is delivered the way the Scottish Government and indeed all the service users want to see it delivered?
Convener, let me assure you that we will update the financial memorandum and we will continue as we move forward in terms of the formulation of the business cases to take account of the current financial and economic circumstances, including inflation. But what I would say to the committee, which you're well aware of, that the financial memorandum and the business cases are not in themselves budgets. And budgetary decisions about spend, of course, will have to take place in the normal way in this Parliament, as you would expect, Convener.
Yes, I do, and I've also noticed you've been very careful with your language, taking account of inflation and reflecting the prevailing rate of inflation. So I can understand that you're not in charge of the budget, Minister, but I think those who will be in receipt of the service are looking to see, well, if there's going to be huge sums of money dedicated to actually setting up this structure, is it going to be hobbled from the start? I mean, it is a flagship policy for the government. One would have thought that ensuring that it does deliver, even against the financial odds that we're currently facing, would be an absolute priority. And it does alarm me somewhat that even at this stage, there doesn't seem to be a guarantee that would be the situation.
Convener, you know how budgets work in this place, and the reason why my language is what it is mm-hmm. because we go through a process in this place in terms of setting budgets. But we need to ensure, no matter what the circumstances are, and I hope that we see some improvement in the public finances, but we'll wait and see. I'm not overly hopeful. But no matter what the UK Treasury does in terms of public finance as we move forward, we have to make sure, absolutely sure, that we are establishing services that are fit for the future. The key aspect of all of this is about improving services. It is about moving away from that crisis spend, which costs a lot on the public purse, but also has that human cost. And we need to change that dramatically, no matter what. Convener, as we progress with all of this, I am more than happy to come before this committee again to talk around about how we move forward in terms of the FM and updating it, around about the business cases, and how we progress with all of this. But what I cannot do here, Convener, is set future budgets, as you well know. The Deputy First Minister would not be very happy with me at all if I were to do that at this committee today.
Indeed. We will now open up the session to colleagues around the table, and the first to ask a question will be Michelle, to be followed by Liz.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everybody. I suppose what I want to do is just focus again on the matter at hand, which is the financial memorandum. There's been a lot of kind of chattering external to this committee about the National Care Service per se, but my own personal view is I always welcome audacious and ambitious projects for change. But at the same time, I recognise, particularly in this case, that it's a large project, longer term outlook, wide breadth of scope. We've got rising inflation has been brought out and it's complex to deliver. So I think, Minister, you said earlier that folks are saying all of this should be covered, which I think you were referring to the extra items that the convener outlined weren't mentioned. Now, I don't think that's true. My frustration has been that despite the fact that the costs, the estimated costs, have in years one and two round about a 50% variance and over 100% variance in years three, four and five, we don't have everything covered. And my frustration was that I expected to see something in the FM that said, we do not know about the following areas. We're going through a process where they'll have to be discussed. We've talked about VAT, for example. And yet, it was as almost though they didn't exist. And that was my frustration, because ultimately, I want to have confidence that the FM represents the best picture at that time, even if they are estimates that have a wide degree of variance, as is the case just now. So knowing this, what would you, and having read everything in readiness for today, obviously, what would you or your team do differently next time to reflect these concerns?
Convener, I'll come first and I'll bring in Ms. Bennett, if you don't mind. I think, you understand that there are currently various unknowns that could result in large cost differentials, such as the transfer of staff and their associated pay terms and conditions, as well as other things like the digital improvements that we may need. At all times, we have been trying to be as transparent as we can in terms of the approach and to highlight the potential costs that may be incurred if the bill were to be passed. As not to either under or overestimate the reality of the situation. As I've stated throughout, these estimates will have to be refined because times have changed since the financial memorandum was written. And we will provide updates and all of that as soon as and if there is any other material change. There are some assumptions that I don't think we can make, because if we make assumptions around about some of the areas of work that are subject to the co-design process, then folks will already think that we have already made up our minds around about how we move forward. And I don't want that to be the case, because I need everybody at the table with open minds. And obviously, there will be parameters around about that co-design. And in those circumstances, as we develop all of that, I pledge to the committee and to Parliament that, again, we will be open and transparent around about the expected financial costs of all of that work. Now, Ms. Bennett is the expert on the financial memorandum. She wrote it. She's probably as sick fed up of me in terms of my questioning and all of this, but she will cover off in some of the other aspects around about this, some of which is within the FM itself.
Thank you. Just to note briefly on that, in paragraph 52 of the financial memorandum, we do note some of those areas of uncertainty, VAT, assets and pensions. And as Minister's outlined, it's important that we go through that process properly. We've sought independent advice on VAT and pensions already to look at the range of options we're working through. And we absolutely will provide further financial estimates for those areas through the business case process.
Going back to my original question, knowing what you know now, for you both, what would you do differently next time? Because I am sympathetic to the complexity and the nature of this type of work. I'm entirely sympathetic to that. But I think it's not unreasonable to suggest that it's just not quite landed at the right level in terms of this finance committee, setting aside the ambition around wanting to change social care from a scrutiny of the financial memorandum, from a confidence perspective. I don't think you could concede, particularly at the first session, the committee emerged with confidence in the estimates and the articulation of the unknown unknowns. So what I'm trying to establish is listening that to that and acknowledging that, particularly perhaps yourself, Ms. Bennett, what would you do differently next time? Can you give some reflections on that? Or if it's unfair, I'll ask the Minister.
So maybe I'll come in on that, convener. So some of the areas that Ms. Thompson has highlighted are mentioned and outlined in the policy memorandum as areas requiring further detailed development, including those costings. And one of the things which we should maybe have done better in all of this is informed folk, communicated with folk a little bit better around about the documentation that we have put forward, that we have laid, as being a suite of documents which are complementary information to support transparency in all of this. So maybe that is something that we could have done better. Now, I think that in terms of the landing of this with some stakeholders, they have picked that up a little better than others. But I think, you know, in that suite of documents, we have been open and transparent around about the work that we have done, the financial memorandum as it pertains to the bill, but also being transparent around about the other work that needs to be done and how we go about doing that.
And I suppose my last point in that, reflecting on engagement with stakeholders and the convener's point and comment about the period during which the consultation was done, engagement with key people about understanding the basis of your estimates being done without prejudice to future decision making, because that's also not come through. I just wanted to pick up on something, Minister, that you said that intrigued me about data collection cost. And I often, this committee, kind of go back to my kind of old life of large transformational change programmes. I'm surprised to note that we don't have what is in effect a kind of unit cost per service by local authority. Can you give me a bit more flavour to that, or have I understood it correctly?
You've understood it correctly. I think one of the main frustrations for me is around about data collection and order that we get services and design services right, not only for today, but for tomorrow. It can be very frustrating getting some very basic information. And we need to turn that around. We need to turn that around dramatically in order to make sure that we have services that are fit for the future. And it is also a frustration in terms of the length of time that it takes to get certain basic information to make key decisions. And I think in all of this, that is not only just a frustration for government, but also a frustration for stakeholders, for those folks that Mr. Gibson mentioned, who feel that, you know, it may take them a little bit more time in order to do some of this data collection work. It may save them time if we actually manage to get all of that data rather than them doing their own research and all of this. And I'll maybe take in Ms. Bell, convener, to add to that too.
Yeah, so I think there's two points here. There is our ability, and I mean our collective ability, whether that be local government, the NHS, or Scottish Government, to understand the data that we have, particularly on social care. So we have done a lot of work already on that. So we now have more data on unmet needs. We have more data on understanding people waiting for care, for example. It has been quite tricky to secure a consistent response to that. We're now at the point where we believe the data is of sufficient quality for publication, so that will happen later on this month. But that has been quite difficult, particularly around the issues of consistency of collection and the logistics that sit behind that, how it's collected, how it's made available, etc. So I think Mr. Stewart makes good points there about our collective understanding of the data that we have and how it's used for improvement, very importantly. So that's point one. The other point I think that the alliance we're making was around the third sector and the requirement to provide data to commissioners. Now, what we find is that if third sector partners are working in more than one local authority, they're often providing different data to different local authorities for different purposes. And the strain that that places upon those third sector partners is actually very significant. Having spent time with third sector partners and seeing that they're perhaps, if they're active in many local authorities, perhaps providing reports on different bases, and that might be right depending on the outcomes that they're achieving, but perhaps to 11 or 12 local authorities in a different format and a different set of parameters and measures, that takes up a significant amount of time for those third sector partners. So I think the point that Mr. Stewart makes there is a really important one and quite significant.
And I think, can I maybe add to that, some of those third sector partners that we are talking about who work across local authorities, often in very specialised services, and many of those local authorities have very few clients indeed, but some of the bureaucracies around about that cause them a lot of grief, cost them a lot of time, a lot of resource, money that they would rather spend on helping folks. So there is a refinement required here, without a doubt.
I think it's a very important point you make, because what we want to be able to do is support this confidence measure, if you like, and to do that we have to compare apples with apples. And I suppose it does equally well bring into question where, if we have concerns being expressed about loss of economies of scale for so on, well, how do we know that's true if we can't do that data comparative of apples with apples? So I agree it's an important area, and it probably feeds into the wider picture. Last question then. I mean, obviously you've agreed to come back to tonight, and I think that that's something that committee is really keen to see. And my last wee question then is, at the end of all this, whether it's 5 years or whatever, whether it's elements are de-scoped or the scope increases, and obviously we've got great uncertainty over the inflation and environment, given this uncertainty, how on earth will we be able to compare ultimate actuals with estimates? This strikes me, given what you're outlining with the data, a major challenge, because that is the ultimate test of the processes that we're going through, where I sort of fully accept the uncertainty because of the scale of the project.
I'm going to take Miss Bennett in first, and then I'll come in. Please, convener. Okay.
Yes, no, thank you. We will continue to track changes to any assumptions that are made. So from when the financial memorandum was done, we've continued to make sure and have an audit trail of any changes to assumptions, mm-hmm. whether that's inflation, as policy and design decisions are made. We will continue to adjust the assumptions that underpin the financial figures to make sure there's a clear trail of where we were from the financial memorandum to where we end up at the end of that period you state. So we'll make sure that is transparent mm-hmm. about what's changed.
So you can see why the additional level of data, those exclusions, the rationale for exclusions, all this sort of thing is so important. Minister, to finish.
I think that officials know my expectation in all of this, because I don't like any surprises whatsoever. I don't want to insult Ms. Thompson, convener, by saying this, but I will anyway, and she can maybe have a go at me afterwards. I am a data anorak. I know that Ms. Thompson probably falls into the same vein. If that's an insult, I withdraw it immediately. But, you know, I want to ensure that we get this absolutely right. That means that, you know, we have to scrutinise this to the nth degree. And it won't just be me, and it won't just be you that will be doing all of this. We have got an immense amount of folks who are helping us with all of this, including people in the Social Covenant Steering Group, and they want to know, without a doubt, all of the workings of this. Some more than others, I have to say, but you know, we are under intense scrutiny in all of this, and that's only right. Beyond that, you know, as I've said, and I'll continue to repeat, I'm more than happy to come in front of this committee or any other committee as we progress to outline how we are moving forward, particularly when it comes to the business cases or where we are making amendments as we go through. I think that is only right. Ms. Thompson is absolutely right that this is a huge piece of work, probably, well, definitely the biggest public service change that there's been since devolution. It is incumbent on all of us that we get it right, and I'm not afraid of scrutiny in that regard.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Liz to fall by Ross.
Thank you. Minister, you said in the parliamentary debate last Wednesday that, and you've just repeated it just now, that this is potentially a huge change to social services should this bill pass. And you also said in that debate that you were very keen to set out the principles and that they ought to be very heavily scrutinised. And you cited that financial sustainability is one of these key principles. Can I ask you, how are we supposed to engage in that scrutiny if we don't have anything like the detail that we need when it comes to the financial memorandum, partly for some of the reasons that Michelle Thompson cited and for some that the convener cited? Because I think, Minister, you have to admit that there are many stakeholders who are deeply unhappy about the fact that they do not have the relevant detail to be able to undertake sufficient scrutiny.
Convener, there are a number of stakeholders who have said that they are unable to carry out the scrutiny that they desire. But what I would say to those stakeholders is have the conversations with us and we will help you through what we are doing here. The convener mentioned Fraser of Allender. They have been in conversation with officials. Anyone can do so. Just like, as I said earlier on, I am more than happy to talk to other folks around about the assumptions that they have made. COSLA, as I said earlier, have made assumptions that we don't recognise, but I'm more than happy to engage with them to see if some of what they have got in terms of their workings is right or not, and take that on accordingly. I think Ms. Smith wants to come back.
Very much so. I don't doubt that there will be conversations. Of course there will. But as a committee and as a parliament, it is our duty to scrutinise any piece of legislation, but particularly when it comes to a very sizeable piece of legislation, we have to be very clear in our own minds about a financial memorandum that accompanies that legislation.
Yeah.
Now, the concern that we have as a committee, and I think I can say fairly safely that irrespective of what we think about the bill, there are concerns that have been laid out because of a lot of the evidence that has been provided to us in the last 3 weeks. And that evidence is on the basis that what is before Parliament is not sufficient for the detail of the scrutiny that is required for us to decide whether this can progress in its current state or whether we have to have a complete sort of different approach to the process. Do you accept, Minister, that the concern is sufficient, particularly amongst those who are trying to scrutinise a financial memorandum, do you accept that there is a cause to pause this bill until there is more detail than is before us just now?
No, I don't. The financial memorandum covers the bill, and you know that is the estimated cost of establishing a national care service as per the bill. What some other folk want at the moment is the detail around about aspects of the costs in terms of delivery of service, and other aspects that we have said will be subject to the co-design process. As I have said to others already this morning, it would be wrong of us to make any assumptions around about any of those costs, because the people that we want to be involved in the co-design would then say they have already made their minds up about how they are going to progress with this, because they have attached a financial cost to this already. And in my responses to both the convener and Ms Thompson earlier, what I have said is that that co-design work will be subject to individual business cases, and I'm more than happy for this committee, for Parliament, to scrutinise all of that as we move forward. We will be open and transparent about all of this, but what we will not do is make assumptions before that co-design work is completed. But I would reiterate, convener, again, this financial memorandum provides the estimated cost as per the bill.
Well, Minister, I have to say, in all my time in this Parliament, it's the weakest financial memorandum that I've ever seen, and that includes some for various pieces of major legislation. But can I just ask you, what would you say in answer to those witnesses who, at our committee, have told us that for some of the projected additional costs to this bill, they've had to actually go and ask civil servants for some further detail because it's not been presented to them as they try to establish their own projections of the financial memorandum?
Well, I already mentioned the Fraser of Allender Institute approaching civil servants around about the financial memorandum. I'll bring Ms Bennett in because she will have featured in those discussions. But as I said earlier, my understanding is that they got no new information at all in that regard. But, you know, we're pointed in the right direction around about the FM itself. But I'll take in Ms Bennett, convener, because she's been involved in those discussions.
Thank you. Yeah, it's correct. It is a very detailed and complex landscape to fully be able to understand the assumptions that underpin every part of this wouldn't be right at this stage, because we've not been through that co-design space. There will be further discussion to be had to make it clear the work that's been carried out, and that will be set out in further detail as time goes through. There is publicly available information, which much of this has been based on, for example, the local finance returns from local government, which can be used by others trying to estimate these costs. So as Mr Stewart has said, we're very open to more conversation to set out how we've come up with these estimates, and indeed take feedback from others.
Yeah, I don't think, Mr Stewart, it's just about having conversations. What this committee is asking for, and what the Parliament will be asking for, is further detail. I completely understand that you could never put out a full set of estimates and call. Completely understand that. But too many of our witnesses and too many people who are making commentaries on this bill are making it very clear indeed that it is extremely difficult to provide the best forecast of costs because there isn't sufficient detail that has been provided by the Scottish Government. And that makes it very difficult for the points that you raised last week in the debate in Parliament, where you set out the laudable aims of the bill, but you made it very clear that it is our job to scrutinise that. And you're right, it is our job to scrutinise it, but forgive me for saying so again, we cannot do that unless there is adequate information on which to base the scrutiny. Do you accept that?
No, I don't, because some of these folks want information and assumptions around about some of the things that we have said will be subject to co-design. And I cannot reiterate this point enough. If we come out with financial assumptions now around about some of the aspects of the work that we want to achieve through co-design, people will think that co-design is a sham. And I want folk to be involved in that co-design to ensure that we have good law, which leads to good implementation, and currently bridges the gulf that there is in terms of that implementation gap. Now, I know that some of the folks out there because I speak to them, want detail about every aspect of service delivery as we move forward. We cannot give that at this moment in time because that would be breaching our pledge to co-design with the voices of lived experience, with stakeholders and others as we move forward. The bill itself is there. The financial memorandum covers the bill, and we will come back again and again with the business cases for the co-design for further scrutiny. But what I will not do is be bounced into making assumptions around about what some of the aspects of the co-design work will actually cost, because folk out there, as I say, will think that we've already made our minds up about how we move forward.
Minister, let me try this from another angle. You've said persistently that this bill is about people. I understand that.
Absolutely.
I understand that. But to ensure that we are delivering first-class services for people, it needs some structures surround that. Now, what the Scottish Government is proposing is that there is a vastly different structure put in place from the existing one. Now, that may have merit. But in order for us to be persuaded of that merit, it is surely incumbent upon the Scottish Government to set out as much detail as it possibly can to help us along the way to persuade us that the change that the Scottish Government wants to make is not just desirable from the laudable aims that you've set out, but is actually workable and deliverable. And at the moment, we have far too many people around the country telling us that they have serious concerns about what it is that they will be asked to do to make that work, and certainly whether the costs are applicable. Do you accept at least that there is very genuine concern, and that's another reason why this bill should be paused for the time being?
I do not think the bill should be paused. I know that some folks are opposed to the change that we're trying to make here. I think that there are concerns. We will talk to folk, listen to folk about their concerns and work our way through with them. But I come back to the point that some folks out there, and you have had it in evidence here, and others, committees again, have had the same, whereby folks want answers to some of the questions that we have said will be subject to co-design. I cannot, at this moment, give assumptions around about that, or we lose the confidence of those folks who want to help us co-design the services as we move forward. I come back to the point, convener. Yeah, we want to ensure good law here. We want to ensure good implementation, and we want to ensure that we bridge that implementation gap. The only way that we can do that well is by having the voices of lived experience and other stakeholders who have not been involved in the shaping of services to this degree before at the table. And as we move forward with that work, we will ensure that the business cases are there and that they can be fully scrutinised by all. I want to be as transparent in all of this as possible, but I'm not going to be able to answer questions now around about certain aspects of this, because if I did, then, you know, the co-design would be said to be a sham by many.
OK, my final question, Minister. Can I just give you the comment of somebody who is on the front line and who at our committee was speaking on behalf of the chief executives of NHS boards, who very much agrees, I think, with the principles of some of the things that you're trying to deliver, but who nonetheless was very sceptical about whether this could be delivered in a way, particularly at the moment when the NHS is facing so many difficulties and when, you know, there is absolutely no spare room within the NHS. He is telling you, Minister, that the NHS bosses are not happy about this bill in terms of its workability. Do you accept what he's saying, Mr. Ralph Roberts?
Again, we continue to listen to NHS board chairs, chief executives and others in all of this, and they are obviously key in helping us design the services as we move forward, and will be involved all the way through this process. Now, I get that some folks want to see delay. You know, I recognise the pressures that there are on out there. But in terms of pressures, in terms of delivery of care itself, that will only grow over the years, because we have a changing demography, a changing population, and we cannot have stasis here. We need to invest now, which we're doing, and we're investing over the course of this winter. But we need to get this right for the future. Stasis is not an option here. We will continue to listen to concerns. We will try and ensure that we address those concerns as we move forward. We will continue to engage. We will continue to listen.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Ross, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, my first question is just in relation to sequencing, because I understand entirely what you said in opening about what Parliament standing orders require you to lay out in a financial memorandum, and I appreciate what you're saying about not preempting the result of co-design processes. But that then, I mean, to me at least, that begs the obvious question, maybe it's a daft laddie question, of why did we not do the co-design processes before reaching this stage of the parliamentary process?
I don't think it's a daft laddie question at all, and it is a ducks in a row situation. I think that what we need to do is progress with the primary legislation and then move on to the co-design for the secondary legislation and you know, the service delivery. I think if we'd done it the other way around, folk could equally have argued, why have you not dealt with the primary legislation, the framework, first before moving on to that co-designing of secondary legislation and services?
I accept absolutely that there's drawbacks to both, but do you accept that the drawback to this sequence of events is the challenge it presents to parliamentary scrutiny of what, as per the government's own words, is the most significant reform taking place in this term?
I think if we'd done it the other way around, then quite probably committee and others would have said, why didn't you do it the other way around? Because the primary legislation is obviously the most important in all of this, Mr. Greer. So I think, you know, that's maybe a bit of a no-win situation for anyone.
Just returning to VAT, I appreciate what you said, as we would all expect, that you're engaged with discussions with the UK government around trying to achieve VAT neutrality, but surely until those discussions reach a conclusion, hopefully a positive conclusion in that regard, the default position at the moment is there will be VAT liability. So I'm not sure why that's not in the financial memorandum, if that is the status quo at present until an agreement for something else is reached.
Take Ms. Bennett, please.
Thank you. Until the status of the care boards are established, it's not clear what the VAT impact will be or not. So at the moment, local government are Section 33 bodies, NHS are Section 41. So depending on how care boards are established will impact the VAT liability that could be incurred. As noted, we've engaged with independent advice to give us further options on that. We do have estimates from 2014, from when IGBs were formed. We're looking to update those estimates now to understand what the scale of that might be. But we are taking our time to work through that with an independent expert.
Convener, there has been a fair amount of questions on VAT today. I'll write to the committee with the detail of where we are at the moment. And, of course, continue to appraise the committee of the advice that we receive, so that you have as much detail as the committee as possible around about where we're at.
I think I would appreciate that, Minister. I would have to say, though, that I think there are other members who want to ask questions about co-design, including myself. I know that Daniel also wants to ask on that, so I think there will be further exploration of that specific issue as we progress. Ross.
I appreciate that, Minister. I think the committee will appreciate that further information. But surely, based on the answer that Ms. Benn has just given, there is at least a range of potential costs that could be assumed for VAT. And my understanding of the standing orders for what's required for financial memorandums, the range could have been put in there.
Okay. I will look at that, Mr. Greer, and we will spell all of that out in the letter around about where we're at.
Thanks. And just one final question from myself. The emergency budget review announced last week included a £70 million saving in the budget line for social care and the NCS. Like, we all understand why the emergency budget review is necessary, so I'm not disputing that, but I'd just like to understand a little bit more how much of that £70 million, if any, was specifically related to NCS costs in this current financial year.
I'll take in Ms. Bell and probably provide you with more detail on that as well.
Yeah, so we have done some reprofiling of the National Care Service budget line, and that includes some slippage due to recruitment issues and to digital aspects of the programme. The estimated reduction is around £15 million. In the NCS line. There is an intention that will be shifted forward into next year to pick up the slippage. So we're clear that the programme at the moment is still on track, but there is some slippage in the programme.
So, Convener, the rephasing that Ms. Bell has outlined is to ensure, of course, that we have the right skills in place as well as we move forward. We will continue to ensure that we have the resource to allow for the meaningful engagement with people with lived and living experience and other stakeholders too. But we'll give you more detail on that issue too, Convener.
That'd be appreciated. Thanks. That's all from me, Convener.
Okay, thank you. John, to be followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener. And I suppose I'm going to be building on some of the stuff that's already been said already. Just on the question of how much planning was done before the bill, you know, came forward, I mean, something like how many care boards there's going to be. I mean, I imagine the costs would be quite different if there's 32, which would match each council area, or say 8 or 9, which would match the health boards as they are. At what stage is the thinking on that at the moment, or is that also a kind of co-design issue?
That is subject to co-design, Mr. Mason. Obviously, in all of these things, there has to be some parameters. If somebody, for example, were to make the suggestion that there should be 1,000 care boards, you know, that's not going to be realistic and could not happen and would be out with the parameters. But we have said that we're open for discussion around about whether those care boards should be coterminous with local authorities or with health boards. And at the moment, and I'm sure the committee is aware of this, there are not 32 IJBs. There are 31, because Clackmannanshire and Stirling are together in this. And again, you know, as part of the co-design process, is there the possibility of others joining up? Would that be something that they would want to do, which, you know, we would look at closely? The other aspect of all of this, and, you know, again, the committee will know about this, is do we look at other options for certain parts of the country? You know, some of the, some, not all of the island authorities have talked before around about single island authority. You know, is that something that would be favourable in terms of delivering services, not just the National Care Service in the future in our island authorities? And we are open to looking at that too.
So can we at least assume that the minimum would be 8 or 9 care boards and the maximum would be 32?
You're trying to paint me into a corner here, and I think that's part of the co-design process. We have to have discussion with folks around about how they see the future. And, you know, I would not paint myself into a corner saying that the minimum 8 or 9 or the maximum 32. And, you know, I think that there will be a fair amount of ideas and suggestions that come out during the course of that co-design work. I've heard a lot of them myself, but I'll leave others to bring that to the table when it comes to co-design.
I mean, one of the suggestions we had was that the IJBs, or the Health and Social Care Partnerships, could just take on some different responsibilities, given that the numbers might merge or vary a bit. And that would save setting up new structures with the inevitable duplication and staff kind of focus on what's going to happen to their careers and these kind of things. Would that not have been a cheaper option to just use the existing structures?
I think we have to make a fair amount of change, Mr. Mason, in all of this. And again, it is the establishment and who is on care boards, which I think is of real interest to folks themselves. You know, for example, you know, I've again not said very much around about who should be around the table. For example, there are very clearly folks who need to be around that table, but you know, there are a lot of suggestions from individuals and from groups around about who should be there, who has been missing at this moment in terms of the formulation of its services in their areas. One thing which I have been clear about is I believe that the voices of lived experience should be at that table with a vote. But, I, you know, again, these matters are subject to the co-design process.
Mm-hmm. But, I mean, at least during the setup process, I mean, it really means that on top of the existing organisations, we're going to have another one, i.e. the Care Board, because the suggestion seems to be that, you know, you can't just switch off other things, the IJB or whatever, on the same day. So, I mean, much as I'm in favour of jobs for accountants, that means, you know, there'll be a finance director in the council, there'll be a finance director in the health board, there'll be a finance director in the health and social care partnership, and there'll be a finance director in the care board. And that seems like quite a lot of duplication.
That doesn't necessarily have to be the case, Mr. Mason. As I said earlier on in a previous answer, there is opportunities here, without a doubt, for shared services. You know, I'm not going to make any comment around about jobs for accountants, but, you know, there is the opportunity for shared service aspects to all of this.
OK, now another point, as we've already noticed, various people have raised VAT so far, and I just wanted to press a little bit more, but I take your point, you're going to come back to us on that. I mean, could you even give us an assurance? You're obviously having talks with HMRC and different bodies. One of the points was raised, a lot will depend on the legal entity which the care boards are, and I just wonder if you could maybe say anything on that. And, you know, is it not possible to say, well, we'll choose a legal entity that we definitely would avoid VAT?
I'll take in Ms. Bennett, first of all, please.
Thank you. So there are a finite number of bodies that the care boards could be. The list isn't a long one. There's quite a bit of work, as police and fire has been mentioned here, in terms of being added to a Section 33 body, which is at the discretion of Treasury to do. So that's what we're working at the moment, to speak to Treasury to understand our plans and to get early engagement with them, similar to police and fire, to what was added to Section 33F, I believe it is, of the VAT Act.
Is that helpful?
OK. Yeah, well, that'll do for just now. Obviously this, and you've said that already, you know, you're going to give us more information as we go forward. Can you just clarify for me, would the financial memorandum be revised before stage three, or are we looking at business cases, which I take it are just a kind of not part of the statutory process? The business cases would be ongoing over perhaps years.
I would have to check on this, but I don't think it's possible to change the financial memorandum before stage three, but let me get back to you on that.
Right. But probably, given that a lot
What we will continue to do as we move forward, as I've said earlier on, is we will continue to update all of our assumptions as we move forward in terms of the FM and in terms of business cases. But I don't think it's possible to change the financial memorandum before...
That's OK. I mean, I'm not too worried about that. But so the business cases, can you tell us how you would see that? Would that be an annual process or maybe six monthly or what? And would that go to the health committee or would that come to us or where would they go?
It's difficult for me to say which committee. I would imagine that a number of committees would want to scrutinise some of these aspects. And I wouldn't want to be held to timescales either, to be honest with you. Convener. As I said, I want to be as open and transparent as we possibly can. So that would be as and when ready, basically, in some regards. I would imagine that not only this committee, but others would want to see such things as soon as they are completed.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the concerns is, and again, that was raised with this witness, is that if it's secondary legislation for some of the rollout of the National Care Service, then there would normally be less scrutiny of that.
But so, again, I've gone on the record in terms of the secondary legislation as saying that we will have consultation with stakeholders, with the public on secondary legislation, and that we will allow the max time for scrutiny in all of this. We need to get this absolutely right. And, you know, I'm not in the business of rushing that secondary legislation. In order for us to get that right, we have to take the time as necessary.
Okay. Now, when it comes to assets, say, like care homes, you've suggested that some local authorities might continue to run them, and certainly Glasgow has some quite modern ones which it has built, or some might maybe be transferred into the National Care Service. Now, it's also been raised with us, you know, how would the finances for that work? Because some councils might have paid off any loans, some might still have loans or PPP or something linked to a new care home. You know, so would the government be taking on the loan as well as the asset? Or, again, is that all about later discussions?
We have, as I said earlier on, made no decisions around about asset or staff transfer, convener. And that is part of the co-design process. And I hope that local government and others will be fully engaged in all of that. I would say to Mr. Mason, that, you know, as it stands at the moment, in terms of provider of last resort, often services are currently transferred to local authorities if there are difficulties in terms of delivery of service. As I've said, the bill provides for transfer if Parliament agrees that care boards become the provider of last resort, to be able to make those transfers possible if there is a collapse in a particular service.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, you mentioned staff transfer then, and that's also been raised with us that, you know, even working for councils, there will be a wide range of terms and conditions for care staff at the moment. And that will be even wider when the third sector and the private sector are brought in as well. I mean, where are we with the costs of kind of trying? Presumably, the aim in the long run is to consolidate all of these, and people would have more consistent terms and conditions.
So, in terms of the pay and conditions of local government staff and the differentials, and if they were to transfer to care boards to the NCS. I think it's 43%, if I'm right, of the care board assumptions in the financial memorandum are down to those staff costs if that were to happen. However, I go back to my point that, you know, no decision has been taken on any transfer of assets or staff, and that's a matter for the co-design project.
Because I think when the colleges kind of went into regions and things, it did take quite a lot of time to get the staffing terms and conditions and pay aligned. And so, you know, would it be fair to say that that's going to be quite a major process?
I'm very well aware of the college aspect of all of this, and I go back to my earlier point of no unintended consequences. We would have to work all of this through, and, you know, we've made some assumptions in the financial memorandum about this. No decision has been taken. You know, it is a matter for co-design, and I go back to my earlier point as well. You know, many local authorities at this moment deliver high-quality care services. Is there a need to transfer those services to local care board control? Probably not, but that's a matter for the co-design.
So just as my final question then, so following on from that, so like the NHS, and because quite a lot of people compare the NCS with the NHS, I mean, the NHS is quite a mixed model because effectively GPs and dentists are private businesses. So it's that kind of mixed model that you are foreseeing on the way forward?
We have a mixed model at this moment, and We will, I'm sure, continue to have a mixed model, but there will be some changes in all of that, because at the end of the day, one of the main things here is ensuring that there is fair work, national sectoral bargaining for pay and conditions, which is extremely important as we move forward, and also the aspects of ethical procurement, where fair work has to be absolutely embedded in that ethical procurement. That is what we need to do to ensure that we attract more folk to the care profession as we move forward, to create the right environment to attract people to come and work in that profession. And beyond that, also to ensure that we can provide the career pathways that young people want but feel are not there at this moment in time. So these are some of the main opportunities of the journey that we are embarking on here. And what I would say in all of this is that if we do not move forward on that front, then it is going to be more difficult to have a sustainable care provision as we move forward.
Okay, thanks so much.
Thank you very much. Daniel, to be followed by Douglas.
So, Minister, you've been at pains this morning to point out that essentially the detail of the service delivery is going to be subject to the co-design phase. Fine. Let's park that for a moment. But can I just ask some points of clarification? You said at the beginning that the point and purpose of this was about standardisation and accountability. Just for clarity's sake, it's not just those two elements, is it? It's also about commissioning, rather importantly. Secondly, it's your contention, that the purpose of this bill is to set up that national apparatus to make possible that centralised commissioning and nationalised sense. Is that correct? And secondly, you're saying that the financial memorandum for setting up that national apparatus, that we have a, notwithstanding the points around what costs may arise from service delivery or additional services, but the costs for setting up that national apparatus are all contained within the financial memorandum. Is that correct? Those three points?
No.
Okay, quite correct frankly, me then.
At no point today have I used the term standardisation, and I never will. What I have talked about is national quality standards which should be adhered to. But there will still be local flexibility around about the delivery of care. So let me make that quite clear. There should and will be local flexibility in terms of delivery of care. So we will have national standards, but this is not what I would term as a standardisation overall. The point around about centralised commissioning, this is not about centralised commissioning. This is about commissioning, again, at a local level. Now, it may well be that as we move forward, that we choose, in cooperation and collaboration with partners, to maybe do some specialised centralised commissioning for more specialist services. Again, that is something that many members of the public would like to see, but this is not about centralised commissioning. Do you want to come in, Dawn?
Yeah, happy to. I mean, this is the process.
Actually, I was really just asking for three brief confirmations of the assumptions, and actually, I understand the different words. I don't actually think I was suggesting anything different. But just on that point, can I just ask then, if it's not about centralised commissioning, can you conceive of a situation where there'll be more commissioning boards than the current number of IJBs, or are you clear that there'll be fewer?
No, I don't see that at all. But again, we are going through a co-design process. I can't see there being more. The national aspect of this is not about national commissioning. But what has been made very clear to us by the public at large and by many of the stakeholders in the third sector and elsewhere, is that there should be national accountability. And that came out again very clearly in the independent review put forward by Derek Feely in terms of the recommendations. And, you know, I have to say that that accountability people feel is sadly lacking. So this is about strengthening local accountability, having national accountability for the first time. And I think that, you know, for many colleagues around this table and in Parliament as a whole, sometimes they don't quite understand the fact that we are not, as ministers, accountable already for some of these services, because a huge amount of correspondence that I get is around about delivery of care services, which we try and help resolve for members. But I have no national accountability, ministers have no accountability, which the public finds difficult to understand and which many members here find difficult to understand. The public want to see that change, and that's the reasoning for the direction of travel that we're taking.
So just looking at the commissioning point in the Feely report, I mean, just reading just the executive summary even, the point around commissioning that I took from Feely is that it needs to be more personalised. Now, you're saying there's going to be, you know, likely to be fewer boards. That means, to my mind, that it'll be done further away from the person. So can I just ask, of all the different points in the Feely report, you know, which was, there was the commission point, there was the standards point, can I just ask why you've pursued this model of essentially, you know, creating these you know, national bodies that will oversee commissioning, as opposed to, and again, in the Feely report, in my mind, alludes to the possibility of reforming the inspection and quality regimes. Was that option explored? Was a financial comparison made of what the difference might be in terms of pursuing that model? Because that would provide you with national accountability and standards as well. I'm just interested in what options were examined.
Convener, I don't like folk putting words in my mouth, and I have not at any point indicated today that there's likely to be fewer care boards. I've not said that at all. What I have said is that, you know, all of this is subject to co-design. And in terms of personalisation, the person-centred approach is going to be at the very heart of all that we do here. And we have moved in a direction of personalisation, which has made some advances, but not in others. And, you know, in all of this, we want to ensure that people have as much autonomy and freedom as they have, they can have, in terms of some of the services that they require. So let me give you an example, because, again, a frustration for me is around about self-directed support. This Parliament passed a self-directed support act, which was very good in intention. Some of it, in terms of the primary legislation, folk have found loopholes in that and have not went with the spirit of that act in many places. We are currently changing the guidance again to try and change that. But we need to go further in terms of allowing people that autonomy and freedom to commission their own care if that is what they want to do. Give them the options that were laid out in the SDS Act, many of which are not available in certain local authority areas. And beyond that, you know, listen to people themselves around about where that has worked for them and where it has failed. There are examples of local flexibilities that have been put in place which have been absolute game changers in people's lives. And yet other people in other parts of the country have not had access to those services, which would equally make their lives much, much better too. So this scenario that I've highlighted here is around about those personalisation of services to a greater degree and putting human rights at the very heart, where, you know, in some places we have not done very well on that front.
So if we're addressing comments to the chair, I'm sorry if people thought I was putting words in their mouth. I was simply reflecting. I believe the words the minister used were that he could not conceive of a situation where there'd be more care boards than IJBs. I was merely making the
I never said that either, convener.
I believe you did, Minister. And we'll consult the official report. But if I misunderstood, misheard that, many apologies. I was just simply making an inference based on what I thought you had said, Minister. I would imagine that a computer system will be pretty key to the delivery of that, pretty key to the delivery of any public services. In recent times, Social Security Scotland's computer system is estimated to going to be costing around £250 million. Police Scotland's, and they didn't get the funding for this, recent estimates for their IT needs for a new IT record system, £300 million. Disclosure Scotland, their IT system delivered a few years ago, cost £80 million. I mean, while we might not know the precise detail of the IT requirements, it is fair to say that in broad terms, in terms of range, we must be looking at a sum in the region of hundreds of millions of pounds, even if it's at that low range. And would you think that those examples are fair comparators, thinking about the sorts of costs that might be incurred by the creation of an IT system for a national care service?
Convener, I'm not going to pluck figures out of the top of my head here and that's one of the reasons why we have said that we will come back to the committee with business cases for other aspects of this. I think, you know, the other thing, convener, around about these issues is we have to have a general stock take of what we have at this moment in time as well, and whether we have the ability to use and utilise current systems and allow them to be able to talk to one another. I have to say, convener, that having been involved in public service for a fair amount of time, there has been some IT difficulties that Mr. Johnson has highlighted, some of them in the past. But also, you know, in my own life, I have been involved in a project where we replaced a system, which quite frankly was the wrong thing to do, because the existing system could and should have been adapted. And we need to take a stock take in all of this and look and see what is required as we move forward and put forward the right business case in all of that. One other assurance that I would give the committee is, because I am very well of IT cost overruns from past life, I would be keeping a very close eye in every aspect of the delivery of that, if that was what was required.
I wasn't really getting into cost overruns. Just, without plucking numbers out there, and I was just giving some I thought were fair and recent comparatives. Just coming back up a layer, would you say that the IT will be an important element, and that it is likely to be a substantial cost component of what's finally delivered?
What I would say is IT is a vital component in almost all that we do nowadays. But I think that the starting point in all of this is, what do we currently have in place, and can that be utilised in order to deliver for what we want? That would be the starting point. And then, you know, you would go and look elsewhere to see what is required as we move forward.
But you've not done that yet.
Again, you know, we would come back with a business case for all of that.
Okay, so just looking at the overall business case of this, we're talking about the setup cost for the national apparatus will be up to the order of £500 million plus. That doesn't include IT at the moment and a number of other items. Can you just at least explain whether or not you believe that cost will be recouped in benefits and whether or not of the £7 billion currently spent on social care and the £8.9 billion spent on community health, whether you think that will drive benefits and efficiency on the current footprint, excluding improvements or increases in the standards of care, just in terms of the as-is, the baseline business case, will that cost be recouped? Will it be additional? Do you expect the cost to go up or down on the basis of this investment?
First of all, I don't recognise the figure of £7 billion on social care that
I think it's in the financial memorandum.
Johnson says at the moment. Okay, I'm just being corrected. That's for 26-27. That's assumptions for 26-27. Okay. Do I expect a recouping of investment? I'm not going to pluck an answer out of my head here, but what I would say, and I refer back to the points that I made earlier, at this moment in time, data collection is not easy. There's a lot of clunkiness out there. There is not a connection. That lack of data, without doubt, will almost inevitably lead to some wrong decision-making at various points, which always costs money. That lack of data means that we don't have the ability at points to shape the services in the way that we should to future-proof them and make them sustainable. So in the long term, will that data collection lead to savings? The answer to that is yes, without doubt. Am I going to sit here today and make assumptions around about what that savings are likely to be? I think I would be foolish to do so, Convener.
Well, that wasn't actually my question. As I said, in broad terms, would it create savings? Would that be recouped? Or is it just going to be additional cost? Because as we sit here this morning, and unless you can correct me, Minister, just even in terms of the scope of the bill as it is, setting up the national apparatus, what we're already saying is that we don't have the full costs in the financial memorandum because it doesn't have things such as, and you said yourself that the IT is an important element of public service delivery, but we don't know the costs of that. And indeed, we already had the convener set out the things which Fraser Vander said are missing, which are the cost of the national care boards, transition, the impact of VAT, which we've acknowledged we don't have, the impact of any change to pension schemes, the extent of potential changes to capital investment and maintenance costs, the costs of health and social care information scheme. Now, some of those things are about service delivery, but many of those are about the national apparatus. Likewise, NHS Scotland has set out that the issues we don't know. We don't know about the cost of phasing the functions. They point out that we don't know the size of the wider savings and benefits. We don't know if the transfer will include adult social care and children and justice social care. The list of health functions that will be transferred, and clarity about future demand. Those are quite a lot of unanswered questions, both about the specifics about running the national apparatus and indeed even just in broad terms about the likely impact, whether it will be more or less expensive of service delivery. Am I wrong?
So, Convener, as I've said on numerous occasions today, the financial memorandum covers the bill. In terms of other aspects of this, without going along the same lines as Mr. Johnson, we have said that in terms of getting this right, we are allowing co-design here. And we will come back with business cases for every aspect of all of this as we move forward, showing costs, showing savings that are likely to be accrued by those investments, showing how we can save in terms of eradicating the implementation gap that we know is out there in terms of the difference between policy and delivery. And we will do all of that openly and transparently. But here today, as I've said, we're here to talk about the financial memorandum of the bill. And, you know, many of the things which you have asked today are not part of the bill. But that's not to say that we will not come back to Parliament, probably again and again, with the business cases, which you will rightly expect to be able to scrutinise to ensure that we are on the right track in terms of social care delivery for the people of Scotland.
Which brings us back to the process. So answer this for me, Minister, because I really don't understand. I can understand why you might not want to legislate for service delivery prior to the framework. That bit makes sense. But what would have prevented you from doing the co-design work and bringing forward a white paper and then bringing forward this framework bill with that white paper very clearly in mind, which would have enabled you to do the co-design, would have answered many of the questions we have in front of us, and would have given us certainty about the scope? Because right now, we actually don't even know, because the co-design works, what functions the national apparatus will need to facilitate. So why not do it that way around? Why not do the co-design and bring forward a white paper and use that as the basis and the context for this framework? But I just don't understand why you didn't do it that way around.
So, if we'd done it that way around, as I said to Mr Greer, likely folk wouldn't have been happy with that either. But the government, set out a number of commitments. The first commitment in terms of National Care Service was to establish a social covenant steering group within 100 days and to take cognizance of the mine of information that they have. We also said that we would publish the bill within the first year of the Parliament, which we have done. And we have also said that in all of this, that we will continue to engage and listen to the voices of lived experience, which we will do. And those folks, along with other stakeholders, will help us co-design that bill. I have trust and faith in these folks in terms of helping us do that. I think, you know, we need to ensure that as many people as possible are involved in that co-design, which I'm quite sure that we will. And in so doing, we will also work our way through to ensure that there are no unintended consequences, as Ms Thompson has asked for us to do earlier on, and to make sure that we provide Parliament with the ultimate amount of opportunities for scrutiny, not only of just the secondary legislation, but also of every aspect of the financial and economic impact of the decisions that are made during that co-design process.
I'll leave it there, Convener.
Douglas. Convener, morning, Minister. I just want to continue on the process that Daniel was mentioning there, because, you know, through our evidence sessions over the last few weeks, you know, Solus, COSLA, SIPFA, NHS, Health and Social Care Alliance and trade unions have all really condemned the approach that's been taken. So it sounds like that it's been rushed in this way because there was a commitment to put this forward in the first year. Would that be correct or not? Because it seems what we've heard so far, it could have been done the other way. We could have had the co-design, and then we could have had a bill that we all understood a lot more coming forward.
I'm not going to reiterate the point I made. If we'd done it the other way, then folks would have said that's not the right way and probably taken umbrage with that as well.
But why would they say it's not the right way? I don't understand that, because they might have had more detail.
Mr Lumsden, I could just imagine if we had done it the other way that you would have been one of the people who would have said you should have done it the other way around, and the most important thing would be to put the primary legislation in play first before
Go back, because what you've said is we need to get this right.
Absolutely.
But just now, I think we're writing a blank cheque because we don't actually know what's going to be coming further down the line.
So I think in all of this, you know, you've mentioned organisations that, you know, want answers to questions, some of which are questions that cannot be answered because the matters are subject to the co-design. Some of the folks who you have mentioned want no change whatsoever, and that is not an option at all, because we have to ensure, no matter what, that social care is sustainable for the future. Beyond that, what I would say is that many of the stakeholders that you have heard from are folks who obviously have power and have influence and maybe don't want to see that change. I think what you also need to do as a committee and other committees of this parliament need to do too in all of this is listen to the voices of lived experience and the change that they want. Listen to some of the third sector organisations who feel that the system at the moment does not work for them. Listen to those folks that want change. We made a commitment, the government made a commitment in its manifesto to introduce a legislation to establish a national care service. That is what we are embarking on. Now, you know, I'm quite sure that there would be arguments galore no matter which way around we had chosen to do this. But, you know, we need to get on with this. We need to have faith and trust in that co-design process and ensure that people who have not had voices thus far are actually at the table making the decisions about the things that affect them on a day-to-day basis in terms of their care and support.
Minister, none of those groups actually came to us and said there should be no change at all. I can't remember that at all. They all said they accepted change, but what they were protesting against is that the bill that's been brought forward has basically no detail for them to get behind or not. You know, if we look at what was it, Unite the Union said about the bill, they said the Scottish Government could not have drafted a more incomprehensible, incoherent and dreadful bill. The plans to transfer services, people and property from local authorities to the Scottish Government are a recipe for disaster and represent an all-out assault on local democracy. Do you not accept, Minister, that the lack of detail is causing these concerns from many organisations right across Scotland?
Well, what I would say from that particular statement there, we've made no decisions whatsoever around about moving staff or assets from local government to the National Care Service. I've made that quite clear today. What we want to do is to make sure that folks are involved in that co-design process so that we make the right decisions as we move forward. Now, there will be some folk, without doubt, who would want to see those transfers of staff and assets, and there will be others who do not. But we need to have that co-design together to discuss those particular issues. I think the other aspect of this from a trade union point of view, and I should probably declare interest as a member of Unison, convener, is that what we're embarking on here provides a huge opportunity in terms of national bargaining, paying conditions, and ensuring that we have the right career pathways for the future. So there are huge opportunities there. But, you know, that statement that there will be wholesale transfer, we've not made any decisions around about that.
So, but do you not admit that the process that you've followed has caused all this uncertainty to take place? If you'd done it the other way around, with the co-design first and then the bill, then there would be less uncertainty for groups like Unite the Union.
As I say, I think if we had moved in another direction, then some folk in Parliament would have said, nah, you have to do the primary legislation first.
Okay. Move on to my next point then. You were mentioned standing orders earlier, but according to the Parliament standing orders 9.3, a financial memorandum should set out the best estimates of the cost savings and changes to revenues to which the provisions of the bill would give rise. Now, we've heard earlier that, you know, this financial memorandum seems to have more financial holes than a sieve. So is there a possibility here that you're actually breaking the Parliament's own rules?
No, I don't think there is. And, you know, as this committee will be well aware, you know, I take my responsibilities in this very seriously and, you know, question to the nth degree the officials who put together a financial memorandum in other documents. And as I've said throughout, this financial memorandum covers the aspects that the bill covers.
Mm-hmm. But, well, there's things like IT that Daniel Johnson mentioned earlier. You know, there's no provision at all in there. And you said you didn't want to pluck
So there's
out.
No provision for IT in the bill, so therefore it's not in the financial memorandum,
but
Mr. Lumsden.
Why is there not? It's known that there will need to be an IT system in to support this. Now, you said you didn't want to pluck figures out of the air for IT system. But figures have been plucked out there for every other aspect of this bill. So why couldn't there have been an estimate, a best estimate in for an IT system?
So, Convener, I've never known Parliament to legislate for an IT system. And, you know, what FM, as every member I'm sure is aware, covers is what is covered in the bill. That is covered by the financial memorandum.
But there's going to be IT costs related to this bill. So surely there should have been some provision for that cost to be in the financial memorandum.
So I cannot make myself any clearer on this, Convener, because IT is not in the bill. The financial memorandum covers the bill. What I have said quite clearly here today, again and again, in terms of the aspects of the other work that needs to be done in terms of co-design and service delivery, we will bring back to Parliament the business cases for all of this work as soon as that work is completed, and folk will have the opportunity to scrutinise, as they will have the opportunity to scrutinise every aspect of secondary legislation as we move forward too. Now, the standing orders are very clear in terms of a financial memorandum covering the aspects that are covered in the bill, and we've done that.
OK, well, I'll move on, because I think we'll get frustrated on that point. In terms of the assets, so they're still, we're not clearer whether they will transfer from a local authority, for example, to a new national care service. That's correct. You said that's going to be part of the co-design process.
No decision has been made on those things, and that's on the table for the co-design process. But I would reiterate what I said earlier to I think, Mr. Mason in all of this. You know, we also have to take cognizance of where there is good service delivery and why would we necessarily make change for change's sake if there is good service delivery.
So what would you say to those local authorities that, you know, their budget will be coming up soon and they'll be looking at their capital plan and they may have new care homes within that capital plan? Why on earth would they keep that in the capital plan when there's so much uncertainty that's been caused by this bill?
Because it is still their statutory responsibility to deliver social care and social work at this moment in time. And I'm quite sure that in all of this, folk will look to the future in terms of delivery for members of the public and not necessarily around about their asset base only.
I agree, but it's going to be there. It's not potentially not going to be their statutory duty going forward. And you know, when there's difficult decisions to be made by local government, I'm struggling. I think you could actually make the situation in care worse by this uncertainty that's been caused, because local authorities, why would they invest? That's my question.
Well, we'll keep an eye on this as we move forward, Convener. But I cannot reiterate enough that the statutory responsibility still rests with local government. There has been no decision taken in moving. This Parliament has taken no decision in making any changes. And while this goes through its course, local government is still statutory responsible. And I would hope that in terms of good governance and in terms of good stewardship, and in terms of ensuring that people get things right for their citizens, that they continue to recognise that they have the statutory duty and they will continue to do their best in terms of service delivery for their constituents and their citizens.
They have the statutory duty today, but they may not have next year or the year after. And of course, they may be burdened with a capital cost for years to come because they don't know what's going to be happening. I'll go on to my next point. You mentioned COSLA figures. I think it was 1.5 billion, I think, they've estimated.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't agree with those figures, Minister? Or?
We don't recognise those figures. And as I say, we're more than happy to talk through the numbers with COSLA around about that. But that is not a number that is attached to this bill, without a doubt it's not.
So
we will have those conversations. If they want to speak to us around about how they arrived at that, we will listen to what they have to say and we will ask them how they've arrived at that, and hopefully we'll get some cooperation on that front.
Because, of course, they're providing the care just now. So it's a few weeks since they've submitted those figures, so should you not have had those conversations before now, before coming to committee?
So we have constant conversations around about...
So did you ask him about that figure?
We have had constant conversations around about data and money, but we have got no explanation for that £1.5 billion, Mr Lumsden.
So have you asked for clarification yet?
Has that been asked for a number of occasions?
We have engaged with COSLA on their figures. The background information has not been forthcoming.
OK, so would you expect to see that soon, Minister, or...?
Well, I would have expected to see it before now, Mr Lumsden. You know, I think that if anybody is submitting any number like that, you know, you've got to have the working behind it. But we don't have that working. But I don't recognise that £1.5 billion. Mm. And I hope that now, you know, that there has been this questioning here, that we can maybe all see the working of that £1.5 billion.
I guess for me that highlights the process that's wrong again, but that discussion should have been had with COSLA before this has even got to this stage, but obviously we disagree.
So we have discussions with COSLA on a constant basis, Mr Lumsden.
Yeah, but not around those figures of how much it costs.
We have discussions with COSLA on a constant basis, Mr Lumsden.
Last question is around the VAT implications. Now, I think last time we were here, we discussed a figure of, I think it was maybe 32 million that might have been a number of uncertainty. But SIPFA seemed to dispute that. So have we got a new estimate on that, or is it still 32 million you think may be at risk around that figure?
There you go, Ms. Mary.
I gave the number of 32 million as what was estimated in 2014 for IGB set up. I didn't give the number of 32 million as an estimate for the VAT implications for this. I noted that was a number that we used in 2014, but we haven't given an estimate yet in terms of the VAT implications as of today's rates.
And as I said, Convener, we'll provide as much information we can on that issue to the committee as soon as.
Okay. Very last point I had. SIPFA, when they were given evidence, said mechanisms are in place to look at the quality of services and drive that up. The question is how we build on that existing arrangements. And they're talking about IJB boards. I've been up and running for 7 years. It's not a long time. There's been a lot of legislation that has been held in reserve that could be brought to take the boards onto the next step. However, it seems that we are throwing the baby out with the bathwater and starting again. I presume then you would disagree with that statement, or maybe explain why can't powers, extra powers, be given to the IGBs around social care?
I disagree that we're throwing the baby out with the bathwater, and we want to ensure that where service delivery is good, that we are exporting that right across the board, and the national standards, the national high-quality standards, will ensure that we are able to do so. I think, you know, in all of this, again, I would come back to the accountability. People out there, people who are cared for and supported on a day-to-day basis, do not feel in many places that the accountability is right. They don't feel that is right at a local level, and they want accountability at a national level. We need to listen to that. I am, you know, somebody who always looks for the very best in everything in order that we can replicate that where necessary. And I think that we have got the ability with those national care standards to do that across the board. But I should also say that all of this also allows for local flexibilities in terms of delivery at a local level. And, you know, many of the things that we have discussed today, Convener, I'm sure will also come into play during the course of the co-design process. And if nothing else, I hope that many members of the public and stakeholders will play a part in helping us get this right as we move forward.
Okay. Brief question from Daniel.
Just a point of clarification. Earlier on, Minister, you were saying that essentially there was transparency here because people could contact you or your officials. A slight point of clarification. We have to go on what is a matter of public record. And while I accept that that's a valuable element of scrutiny for us, critical element of all of this is actually public scrutiny, public accountability. So if you need to be able to make direct contact, which the public cannot, I'm assuming, is that not... do you accept that we have to go on what is a matter of public record and what's been publicly published, and we can't really rely on private conversations such as the ones that Fraser Vallander have had to rely on?
I'm quite happy if folk write to us about particular things, we respond, that's a matter in the public domain. I want all channels open, but I also want to be open and transparent about all of this as we move forward. We will put as much in the public domain as we possibly can. The reality as we move forward anyway is we will have so much folk involved in all of this anyway, it's public. You know, in terms of those co-designs and other things, in terms of the formulation of the business cases and all of the other work that we do as we move forward, we will put that out there as soon as we possibly can. I want a situation. I was at a Camp Hill community here in Edinburgh the other week, and a woman there said to me, you won't like this because I'm going to be very challenging. That's what I want in all of this. We need to be challenged in order to get this right. But we need to be challenged not only by some of the folks who come into play in committee on a regular basis, we actually need to be able to give the public the opportunity to challenge and to help shape these services as we move forward, which has not happened to the degree that it should have in the past.
Well, it's been a long session, Minister, and in time-honoured fashion, I'm going to finish up by asking a couple of more questions. I do have many questions I have lined up here.
That surprises me not, Convener.
And yourself, I'll just ask a couple. And it's really for, the word clarification we use in this is about clarification. Co-design has been mentioned on myriad occasions throughout. So yep. If we go back to what Donna Bell actually said in giving evidence, she said the approach has been almost universally welcomed by people who want to be involved in shaping the National Care Service and the delivery of services that they use now are likely to use in the future. That was reinforced at the National Care Service Forum a few weeks ago. And Donna also said... the bill sets out a framework for change. The detail relies very much on co-design with people with lived experience of and people who deliver community health and care support. Our partners and stakeholders will also play a vital role in that co-design. But the issue for me is twofold. One is, what is a timescale for delivery of that co-design? Because we're talking about, it seems to me, and you've touched on this, a whole plethora of individuals and partners who will be involved. Now, the unions and organisations such as COSLA, etc., claim that engagement, in their view, has not been what they would have anticipated. So how do we actually ensure that that co-design is not... We don't end up with a situation, whereby, they say a camel is a horse designed by a committee. We end up with something which does actually work. But how do you actually put weight on what stakeholders say? So, for example, if someone is a care user, how do you balance the weight of their experience with, for example, the institutional experience of an organisation such as COSLA? To get this right. And I do realise that this kind of approach has been used in developing Social Security Scotland.
Absolutely.
And was done so successfully. But first, so it's really timescale and how do we balance the competing engagements that we've discussed?
So, Convener, you're right to point out that this is not new. We have done this previously with Social Security Scotland with some success. We've now launched the co-design panels. And are looking for partners to promote sign-up of frontline staff to the Lived Experience Partner Panel. To support this, the NCS programme will shortly advertise introductory seminars, which you will be able to sign up to online. And there will be co-design training, which will be associated with specific themes. And we have got a number of themes which we'll send you more detail about. In terms of timelines, Convener, again, we will write to you, but this is going to be ongoing. as we move forward. We have got to get this right, and we have got to continue to consult and co-design as we move forward. And in terms of balancing the views of competing interests, I think we managed to do that fairly well in terms of Social Security Scotland. Again, some of the folks that we had involved in co-design of Social Security Scotland are at the forefront of helping us with this co-design. But we'll put some more of that in depth to the committee in writing, because I've got pages of notes here, convener, which I'm sure, quite sure, you don't want to sit and listen to me for another hour.
Yeah, I'm sure you have. I mean, I understand stage one of the bill is 17th of March, so I think we'd be keen to see what progress we've made up to then.
Sure, absolutely.
Now, the last question really is the $64,000 question, I suppose, from some of the people who've given evidence to us, and it's regarding the financial memorandum directly. So, for example, Solas said that a lot of the Scottish Government's response to their concerns has been, and I quote, "We'll cross that bridge when we come to it," or "That's a decision that can be taken locally." And they go on to say the proposal is well-intentioned, but doesn't give us certainty we're going to get something that will deliver consistent care services across Scotland. Of course, Cosler said that, in their view, the financial memorandum delivers an unacceptable lack of clarity. And when I asked Cosler, SEEP Fund Solas, whether they thought the financial memorandum should be revisited, each of them said yes. So what's your response to that?
My response to that, convener, is that, as I've said today, we will continue to update forecasts, business cases, everything as we move forward. But I would reiterate the point that I've made again and again today. The financial memorandum covers what is in the bill. I think what SIPFA, COSLA, Solas and others want answers to things which are not contained within the bill. And they will have those answers. But they will have those answers after the co-design and when the business cases are built up. I think there is a big difference between what they want to see in a financial memorandum to what is actually in the bill, and the financial memorandum covers what's in the bill.
Okay, thank you. Are there any final points, Minister, before we wind up?
No, I'm very happy, convener, to continue to engage with the committee as always. And you can be assured that as our work continues, we will update you as and when.
Okay, well, thank you very much for your evidence today. I'd also like to thank your colleagues, Fiona Bennett and Donna Bell. The next item on our agenda, having covered the public part of today's meeting, will be discussed in private, in which we will consider the evidence that we received today. So I'll now call a break until 11:55 to allow witnesses and the official report to leave.